Yes, sir, we are live.
Yeah, thank you. So good evening, everyone in the audience, and thank you very much for joining us today for this wonderful session. And welcome to the platform, which is Ruma Digi Conclave, sponsored by Zydus Inovia. I welcome Dr. Shalu Basin Gagneja, ma'am, to the show as a speaker today. Today's topic is conventional DMARDs with addition of novel DMARDs in rheumatoid arthritis, a very, very interesting topic today, which has been deliberated by Dr. Shalu Basin Gagneja, ma'am. Welcome to the show, and thank you very much for joining us today as a speaker and taking your precious time out for us. Moreover, Dr. Shalu Basin Gagneja, ma'am, is a consultant rheumatologist. Ma'am is Director of Rheumatology at Primus Super Specialty Hospital, Chanakyapuri, Delhi, and her own clinic, Gagneja Specialty Clinic. Going more brief into the introduction part, would like to give a little more brief about the experience that ma'am is holding. Ma'am is a renowned rheumatologist, consultant rheumatologist, having a experience of around and more than 15 years. Specialty interest are connective tissue diseases, crystal arthropathies, musculoskeletal ultrasonography for diagnosis and management. Qualification, ma'am has completed DNB in internal medicine from National Board of Examinations India in May 2008. Clinical fellowship in rheumatology from National University Hospital Singapore. Musculoskeletal ultrasonography training at National University Hospital, Singapore. Ma'am is holding numerous national and international journal publications. And moreover, ULAR course for ultrasound imaging of joint has been completed by ma'am. Then APLAR intermediate musculoskeletal imaging and intervention workshops at Taiwan, ma'am has attended and completed. Also a life member of Indian Rheumatology Association, which is a renowned and most respected platform at India. Then faculty for DNB Rheumatology and Clinical Fellowship Program. So this is all about ma'am and her introduction. Thank you very much, ma'am. And welcome to the Ruma Digi Conclave. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you.
You can share your presentation, ma'am.
Yeah, just a minute.
Yeah, we can see the presentation. Yeah.
Good evening, everyone. Thanks for sparing time for me, and thank you, Zydus, for giving me this opportunity. I hope my screen is clear so that I can start off. Is
it? Yeah, you can start, ma'am. But before you go ahead, just request for the audience that in between you have any question, you can just type your question in the chat box, and same I will ask to the ma'am, and it will be addressed by the ma'am at the end of this session. So thank you very much, ma'am. Over to you.
Right, thank you. So today I would be talking about the conventional DMARDs. And with the addition of the novel DMARD, which is a very interesting and a new concept which has come up. So basically, I would give a brief introduction. Then I will have a quick recap of the conventional DMARDs, which we most of us are actually aware of. So it will just be a kind of a quick recap. And then I would be talking about the novel DMARD, that is the igrutimod, which is a new addition to the family of DMARDs in rheumatoid arthritis. So rheumatoid arthritis is a chronic inflammatory disease, which we know causes pain, swelling, stiffness in the affected joints. It affects around 1% of the adult population. And the disease varies. Sometimes it is mild with occasional flares, and sometimes it is severe disease with severe joint damage and disability. So our treatment goal is to achieve remission or low disease activity, that is treat to target. We need to prevent radiological progression, reduce joint inflammation, maximize the joint function, and prevent the joint destruction and deformities. So this is the ACR treat to target approach, in which we need to maintain remission or low disease activity, which we calculate by the dash 28 square or many other methods, but that's the most commonly used. And here, if any patient comes with established rheumatoid arthritis, then according to the disease activity, we either start with a monotherapy or we may have to increase the DMARDs to be used. We may need to add other conventional DMARDs, or we may need to add biologicals. And this is how we treat the patients to target. So the various treatment approaches is, apart from the medical therapy, which I'll talk about, is surgical treatment, and with that simultaneously physical and occupational therapy. But we will talk mainly about the medical therapy. So again, the medical therapy here is to optimize the outcome of rheumatoid arthritis. So we need an early diagnosis with early treatment. And we, again, I'd like to here stress upon that we need to strive for remission in all patients. Along with that, we need to monitor carefully for the treatment toxicities and consider the comorbid condition. So the DMARD, it's not like you use this for this. So it's according to the patients and their comorbid conditions. So the medications which are there are analgesics, anti-inflammatory agents, which include glucocorticoids, the conventional disease-modifying anti-rheumatic drugs, and the biologicals. So here today we'll be talking about the conventional drugs. The disease-modifying anti-rheumatic drugs, that is the DMARDs, are the most important agents that are used in treatment of rheumatoid arthritis. They suppress the symptoms, delay joint damage, and potentially delay the deformity. The choice, as I said, is empirical and based more on the balance between toxicity, efficacy, the patient profile, and the prescriber's preference can also be taken into care of. Now, the advantages are that disease progression is slowed down, there is decreased pain and inflammation, and there is retardation of the joint erosions. The commonly used DMARDs are methotrexate, sulfasalazine, hydroxychloroquine, leflunomide. The others are cyclosporin, azathioprine, cyclophosphamide, which are not used much in clinical practice. So we'll be talking about the first four ones. Coming to the anchor drug, that is methotrexate. It is the most preferred DMARD of most rheumatologists. It has a relatively rapid onset of action, that is 6 to 8 weeks, has a good efficacy as been proved in numerous studies, favorable toxicity profile, ease of administration, and low cost. So basically, it blocks the mechanism of action is that it blocks the dihydrofolate reductase, that is the folate path, through the folate pathway, and also increases the release of adenosine, which in turn leads to decreased inflammatory markers. Basically, all the DMARDs, what they do is they block the inflammatory cascade. That is the basic mechanism of action of all of them. 70% of the drug is metabolized after oral metabolism. The T-half is 6 to 9 hours, and the excretion is mostly through urine. The oral bioavailability decreases with increased dose, especially when the dose is more than 15 milligram, and that's when we should shift the patient to parenteral methotrexate. Dosing, we generally start with 10 to 15 milligram per week. The maximum dose which we can go up to is 25 to 30 milligram per week. In kids, the dose is according to the weight, that is 0.3 to 1 milligram per kg. Parenteral route of administration is preferred as the bioavailability of the drug increases steadily with the dose increase, unlike the oral administration, and the side effects are lesser. Combined, because methotrexate acts through the folate pathway, so combined use of folic acid abrogates some of the side effects without affecting the efficacy. Now, coming to the side effects, the main side effects are stomatitis, oral ulcers, mild alopecia, GI upset. These all are related to folic acid antagonism, and using of folic acid along with methotrexate can decrease these side effects to a significant extent. then hepatotoxicity is seen, although it is rare, and with controlled monitoring of the liver functions, abstinence of alcohol, these are even lower. However, if other hepatotoxic drugs are being used, or a patient is a chronic alcoholic, or there is liver disease associated, then there is increased chance of hepatotoxicity. Myelosuppression can be, bone marrow suppression again is because of the folic acid antagonism, which can be corrected with folic acid supplement. Severe pancytopenia can be seen in patients. Again, here, if because the drug is eliminated mainly through the renal pathway, so if there is an underlying renal insufficiency, in these patients, there are more chances that they develop myelosuppression. So we need to take care of that. And along with that, again, regular monitoring is required. Pulmonary involvement side effects, actually, one of the important is hypersensitivity pneumonitis, which is again rare, but we need to keep it in mind because patients can present with cough, dyspnea after intake of methotrexate. And the thing is that methotrexate, when used, the dose and the duration does not correlate with these symptoms. So after ruling out any infections or any other lung disorder, we should think of this. And once we are thinking of hypersensitivity, the drug should be stopped immediately. And sometimes patients require corticosteroids for managing the hypersensitivity. Then the monitoring of the blood counts with differentials, hepatic enzyme and renal function tests, these all need to be done in patients at baseline. And then every 2 to 4 weeks for the initial 3 months of initiation of treatment. And then after that, once the patient has been on treatment and the dose has been stabilized, the test can be done every 8 to 12 weeks. Certain precautions, methotrexate is contraindicated in pregnancy and lactation. It should be stopped 3 months before conception and should not be used in patients with renal dysfunctions, pre-existing bone marrow diseases, immunodeficiency, and severe hepatic disorders or active infectious disease. Coming to the second drug, that is sulfasalazine. Now, this is another drug which is actually used as a common DMARD. However, it is commonly used in combination and not as a single monotherapy. It basically contains an anti-inflammatory and an antibiotic, acetyl salicylic acid and sulfapyridine. It takes 6 to 12 weeks for onset before it shows its benefit. In the intestine, it breaks up into 5-aminoacylic acid and sulfapyridine. For rheumatoid arthritis, sulfapyridine and sulfasalazine are the active moiety which actually help in the treatment of rheumatoid. As all DMARDs, it releases inflammatory inhibits the release of inflammatory cytokines and blocks them. Examples are interleukin 1, 6, 12 and TNF-alpha. So basically it reaches the colon. It's mainly absorbed in the colon, where the azo bond is cleaved and it breaks up, producing the sulfapyridine and 5-aminosalicylic acid. The half-life is around 6 to 17 hours, and it is extensively metabolized in the liver while excreted in the urine. The dosing, we initially start with 500 milligrams once a day and increase it gradually, and we can go up to generally, the dose is 1 gram twice a day, but the maximum dose which we can use is up to three grams per day. Again, the side effects are not major and they all can be managed without specific measures. Anorexia, headache, nausea, pruritus, leukopenia is common, and hypersensitivity reaction, although rare, but we need to keep in mind and ask the patient about any sulfur drug allergy before starting the patient on sulfasalazine, because this can lead to severe hypersensitivity reaction. Again, the monitoring which is needed at baseline and every 2 to 4 weeks for the initial 3 months is the complete blood count, liver functions and creatinine. And these need to be done once after 3 months of treatment, they can be done every 8 to 12 weeks. Precautions are sulfur drug allergy, severe thrombocytopenia, acute viral hepatitis, and certain classes of chronic hepatitis. Next is hydroxychloroquine, a much talked about drug in this COVID era. So hydroxychloroquine is the best tolerated DMARD. It is used mainly for early mild rheumatoid arthritis and generally in combination with other drugs. It is an immunomodulatory and anti-inflammatory in action and has a slow onset of action, 6 to 12 weeks before it comes into action. It suppresses the T lymphocyte response, decreases leukocyte chemotaxis, stabilizes the lysosomal enzymes and trapping of free radicals, all causing anti-inflammatory and immunomodulatory effects. It is rapidly absorbed and widely distributed in the body tissues and extensively metabolized in the liver and eliminated by the urine. It is eliminated very slowly from the body because it gets absorbed, especially the melanocyte-containing cells absorb it, and it persists in the tissues for months. The T-half is 40 to 50 days. The dosing is generally 200 to 400 milligram daily, and by weight, it should not exceed 6.5 milligram per kg per day. In kids, it's 3 to 5 milligram per kg per day. Side effects can be loss of appetite, stomach upset, skin rashes. It increases photosensitivity, headaches, then neuromuscular headaches, dizziness, tinnitus, muscular weakness. Irregular conduction defects are very rare but have been reported. And another thing we need to keep in mind is hypoglycemia. So patients who are diabetics, they need to take care. The medicines for diabetes need to be adjusted because it causes hypoglycemia. So we need to take care of that. Well, the most important thing to keep in mind is the ocular toxicity in hydroxychloroquine. The defect in accommodation, blurring of vision can be seen. And the most important is the irreversible retinal damage that has been observed, who have been treated with long-term or high doses of hydroxychloroquine, who have severe kidney damage or are using tamoxifen along with the drug. So there is typically bilateral bullseye maculopathy with retinal pigment epithelial cell depigmentation. Testing of the paracentral visual field actually is an important test because it can pick up the defect before irreversible damage occurs. So when, according to the ACR recommendation, when prolonged therapy with an anti-malarial is contemplated, we need an initial baseline and periodic eye examination. Ideally, it is annually after every 5 years. However, the rheumatologists consider doing it annually from the beginning, generally. But the consent guidelines say it should be done annually after every 5 years. No routine lab investigation is required once the baseline has been done for hydroxychloroquine alone if being used. Now, the last of the conventional DMARDs is leflunomide. It is a potent immunomodulatory drug, and the dose we start at 10 to 20 milligram per day. Initially, a loading dose was suggested, but that is not used because of the severe gastrointestinal symptoms associated with it. Clinical improvement generally is seen in 4 weeks after starting the drug. Again, it has anti-inflammatory effect. It undergoes rapid conversion both in the intestine and the plasma to its active metabolite. It inhibits dihydroaurate dehydrogenase that inhibits the pyrimidine synthesis at lower concentrations, and at higher concentrations it inhibits tyrosine kinase, thus cell signal transduction. It also decreases IL-8 and IL-10 synthesis and TNF-alpha dependent activation of cells. So all of them blocking the inflammatory cascade. The bioavailability is 80% with a T-half of 14 days. It is metabolized in the liver and eliminated by liver and kidney equally. The most common side effects seen with leflunomide is diarrhea, which is generally dose related and can be controlled by decreasing the dose. Elevated liver enzymes is seen, and more if other drugs such as methotrexate is being used, alopecia and rash. Hypertension and increase in cholesterol has also been seen. There has been significant weight loss seen with leflunomide, and increased side effects are seen with drugs, other drugs which are hepatotoxic. So administration of colistimine or activated charcoal helps in rapid elimination of these drugs. So if we use 8 gram thrice a day for 11 days, that can eliminate the when required in toxicity. The monitoring, so again here we need the complete blood count, liver function test, creatinine monitoring every 2 to 4 weeks initially for 3 months, and then later on every 8 to 12 weeks. The precautions we need here again is it's contraindicated in pregnancy and lactation, active infection, severe hepatic dysfunction and lymphoproliferative disorders. So once we're done with the conventional DMARDs, I would now like to talk about the addition of the novel DMARD, which is Igoratimod. So this is the newest DMARD which has come up recently. It is a small molecule DMARD. Chemically, it is related to NSAIDs, nimesulide and fluocinolide. It has a chromone core framework and two chemically different groups at different positions. And it has an anti-inflammatory and immunomodulatory action. It was approved in Japan and China as a DMARD in rheumatoid arthritis in 2012. So it has a Tmax of 4 hours, a protein binding of 93% with 20% of urinary excretion. So the mechanism of action is varied. It inhibits the immunoglobulins IgG and M. It inhibits inflammatory cytokines IL-1, 6, 8 and TNF. It has an anabolic effect on bone metabolism by stimulating the osteoblast. Blastic activity and decreasing the osteoclastic activity, and it inhibits the cyclooxygenase 2 enzyme, so that's as it is related to the NSAIDs. So coming to the indications, so igrutamide is used in the treatment of active rheumatoid arthritis as an add-on therapy. So it can be used in patients who have inadequate response to methotrexate, who are intolerant to methotrexate and other conventional DMARDs, or patients who have inadequate response to biological DMARDs. The dosing is 25 milligrams once a day for 1 month, and then we increase it to 50 milligrams, but the maximum dose is 50 milligrams daily and should not exceed the same. Coming to the side effects, so the hepatic side effects are around 10 to 20%. They include mild increase in the liver enzymes, increase in the bile acid, and for this, regular monitoring is required. Hematologically, cytopenias can be seen. Gastrointestinal symptoms are abdominal bloating, discomfort, gastritis. Renal, there is increase in N-acetyl glucosamine and increase in beta 2 macroglobulin. RBCs, WBCs, and sediments are seen in the urine. Hypersensitivity reaction can be seen, and there is increase in blood pressure. Coming to the monitoring, we need to monitor the complete blood count and liver function tests at the baseline, and initially biweekly for sometime, and then we monitor the blood test every month. Now coming to the precautions which we need to take. So interstitial pneumonitis has been reported. So whenever we are considering that, the drug needs to be stopped immediately. Low body weight, although there are not much studies on that, but it has been seen that patients with very low body weight, that is less than 40 kgs, these patients have increased chances of side effects, and when seen, the drug should be stopped immediately. Then an important thing is the interaction with warfarin. So igrutamide, if used with warfarin, it increases the bleeding chances, so it is contraindicated in those patients who are on warfarin. And concomitant use with NSAIDs should be avoided because of the increased side effects because of NSAIDs, such as peptic ulcers and gastritis. So contraindications are pregnancy and lactation, severe hepatic dysfunction, renal dysfunction, peptic ulcers, as it has similar effect to NSAIDs, hypersensitivity, and warfarin therapy. As I told you, it increases the bleeding chances. So now, once we know about the new drug, now I would like to tell you some of the studies which have actually helped us to reach to this conclusion that these drugs are actually efficacious and safety-wise, they can be used in rheumatoid arthritis. So to start off with, as a monotherapy, so this is one of the studies. It is a double-blind, randomized, placebo-controlled, multicentric study that studied the safety and efficacy of igarotamide in the treatment of patients with active rheumatoid arthritis. And it was seen that it is a slow-acting drug and effective in the treatment of rheumatoid arthritis, and was well-tolerated and had significant efficacy as compared to the placebo group. Then coming to the second study, that is the comparison with methotrexate, that is the anchor drug. So here again, it was a multicentric, randomized, double-blind controlled trial in which the treatment of active rheumatoid arthritis patients was done with igarotamide and was compared with methotrexate. So the results actually indicated that igarotamide, when used at a dose of 50 milligram per day, is effective as well as tolerated and well tolerated as methotrexate, and represents a new option for treatment of patients with active rheumatoid arthritis. So just so patients were actually divided into three groups, and one group was used 25 milligram of the drug and later on was shifted to 50. The second group used 50 milligram of the drug for 24 weeks, and group three used methotrexate for 15 milligram for 20 weeks. And the results showed that there was no difference in the ACR20 for the group two and three. And the ESR, CRP, and rheumatoid factor also improved. So the efficacy of igarotamide was not lower than methotrexate, as suggested by this study. Then another study compared its use with sulfasalazine. So the efficacy of igarotamide versus sulfasalazine as the first-line conventional DMARD for rheumatoid arthritis. And here again, it showed that it was better as compared to sulfasalazine in control of the disease for rheumatoid arthritis. So the DASH score at baseline was done to show the, and at 6, 12, 24, and 36 weeks was done to define the improved response. And the rate of responders at the month 36 was 85% in the igarotamide group and 65% in the sulfasalazine group. So suggesting that efficacy of igarotamide is better than sulfasalazine as a first line drug. This study also showed that the patients who were on prednisolone, the rate of decrease in use of prednisolone dose was also more for igarotamide group. So it is a better steroid sparing agent as compared to sulfasalazine. Now, once we have compared it to the conventional DMARDs, this is a study that was done to show its efficacy as an add-on therapy. So the efficacy and safety of a combination of igarotamide and methotrexate therapy was for active rheumatoid arthritis was done by a randomized control study. And it was seen after 24 weeks of treatment that methotrexate plus igarotamide showed a statistically significant lower tender and swollen joint count, better patient assessment of pain, lower ESR-CRP, improved DASH-28, and a better HAC score than patients treated with methotrexate alone. As we can see here, the ACR 20, 50, and 70 response was much more in patients who were on methotrexate and igrutamide than patients on methotrexate alone. Then coming to igrutamide with biological agents, because a lot of our patients are already on biologicals. So this was a study which was done to compare. There were three groups. Well, group A was etanercept was used at 25 milligram twice weekly with methotrexate at 15 milligram per week. Group B, etanercept was used along with igrutamide at 50 milligram daily. And group C, igrutamide was used as a single drug at 50 milligram per day. So this actually showed that group A and B had significant improvement in response as compared to group C. And it was shown that etanercept when combined with igrutamide has a good safety and a remarkable efficacy in treating active rheumatoid arthritis with non-significant adverse events. So once we know that this drug can be used, the next question which will come to our mind is how safe is it long term? So again, there were some studies which were done to look for long-term safety of igrutamide in patients with rheumatoid arthritis. So this was a 52-week multicentric post-marketing surveillance study done in patients with rheumatoid arthritis, and which showed that patients had tolerable safety profile with non-significant renal and liver and gastrointestinal toxicity and an improvement in the rheumatoid arthritis activity. So igrutamide can be considered as a useful treatment option for patients with rheumatoid arthritis. So coming to the end of my presentation, the whole concept of today's presentation was to know that where do we place igrutamide in the present scenario. So when what this whole thing comes to the conclusion is that it can be used in patients who are intolerant to methotrexate and other conventional DMARDs, because it has been well established that it can be used as a monotherapy with significant results. Then it can be used as an add-on therapy in adequate response to methotrexate and has shown significant efficacy. And lastly, it can also be used where patients have inadequate response to biological DMARDs with a considerable safety profile. So I think it is a new drug which has come up, and we have more options so that we can treat our patients to target and prevent them to lead a life of disability and joint deformities. Thank you so much for your kind attention.
Thank you very much, ma'am. Thank you very much for your wonderful session on entire conventional DMARDs plus addition of novel DMARD. Thanks a lot that you have spent a lot of time on novel DMARDs, wherein it is very important for everybody in the audience to know about the role and the exact placement of IGRA DMARD in the therapy. Moreover, ma'am, moving on to the question answer time, there are a few questions which has been asked from the audience. Dr. Siddharth, he is asking, can you please discuss your approach of combining conventional DMARDs in rheumatoid arthritis?
Okay, Dr. Siddharth. The conventional DMARDs he's asking, right?
Yeah.
Okay. See, the approach is, as I said, you know, we need to treat to target the patient. So as such, there is no protocol that you start with one drug and then you shift to the other or you add on. So depending on the patient's profile, like when a patient, young, elderly patient comes, we need to look into the renal function. So if there is a deranged renal function, then we cannot use methotrexate. So in that case, we will start off with leflunomide, and we can add on later on, we can add sulfasalazine if required. Similarly, if a young patient comes with early rheumatoid arthritis, we start with hydroxychloroquine and methotrexate. So, and combination is we need to, again, as I said, we need to keep monitoring the patient, and the disease should be in remission. That is, the DASH 28 score should be less than 2.6. So if the patient has not achieved remission, we need to add on another DMARD. And that again depends on the clinical scenario and comorbidity. So if some patient is a chronic alcoholic who has underlying liver disorder, there we would not try to avoid using methotrexate and leflunomide. So we'll have to go on with the less toxic drugs.
Right.
I hope that answers the question.
Yeah, thank you, ma'am. Then coming to the next question, to diagnose rheumatoid arthritis, is anti-CCP is must? What is your view on that?
Okay, see, for us, rheumatoid arthritis is a clinical diagnosis. Rheumatoid factor and anti-CCP are definitely required for diagnosis, but they are more of prognostic factors. So if a seropositive patient has more chances of joint damage and early joint damage, so aggressive treatment is required for those patients. Otherwise, I mean, it's, if the rheumatoid factor is high, it's like more than 3 to 4 times the normal range, then, and the patient has a typical clinical symptoms of rheumatoid arthritis, that is also sufficient. So it's not like we really need to do it. If it is not available or the patient is not able to do, and you clinically feel and the rheumatoid factor is significantly high, so sometimes the rheumatoid factor is just, you know, a point or so high, so that is not considered, that can be false positive. So it has to be significantly high to say that the rheumatoid factor is positive. So definitely, the diagnosis, it is important to put a stamp on the disease, but not absolutely 100% necessary.
Right, ma'am. Then there is one more question. The drug of choice in rheumatoid arthritis to start, should we start multi-drug therapy or monotherapy? I mean, I think that is the question. And what else?
So here again, the drug of choice actually is the anchor drug is methotrexate, because it is a very good, has a good efficacy, and it can be, you know, easily available and easily tolerable, low cost. So that would be the first drug to be used. Most rheumatologists start off with that drug. But again, as I said, it depends on individual patients, his comorbidities, his condition, and how bad the disease is. If the disease is really bad, we may need to start with glucocorticoids initially and then taper them down after a short course of time. And sometimes if the disease is very severe with severe deformities, we may start with two drugs initially, the multiple drug therapy.
Right, ma'am. So these are all the questions which came from the audience. I must say, very fruitful session for everyone. And it was really a great experience for all of us in the audience, including me, that we got a lot of insights about initial therapy, or I can say primary therapy of rheumatoid arthritis, which is conventional DMARDs. And moreover, the detailed discussion on igratimod, which is the novel DMARD at the moment. So thank you very much, ma'am, for your kind guidance and sharing experience, in clinic experience, which is more important nowadays. So thanks a lot, ma'am, taking your precious time out for us and giving us this insightful session. From entire audience and from Zydus Synovia family, I really appreciate your session today, and thanks a lot, ma'am, for giving us your time. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, everyone in the audience, and have a great weekend. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.